having seen or experienced, there are many cases, the more we try to extend our kindness and honesty towards others, the more they come and disturb us and try to take the advantage of us. Then they decide, then why not? We also practice the same method. So in future, there is no kindness and no honesty. But they are not correct. They are not understanding people who think in that way. Now these are the problems that we have to face if we really want to live in this world. Worldly conditions are such that we never experience complete satisfaction in our life. Whether we are rich or poor makes no difference. Always there are some sort of unsatisfactoriness. So, when the rulers started to punish them, those culprits who violated peace and happiness of innocent people developed their cleverness and cunningness and their energy for their protection, to avoid, to escape. And they tried to find out loopholes to escape from the punishment. The human mind is such that all the existing laws, punishment and everything created by the man's mind, by using man's mind. And the same man's mind find out the loopholes also to escape and violate. That is why everybody knows how to escape by violating the existing law. And punishment also cannot stop all the existing crimes and harmful practices which endanger the society. There are many who were sentenced to imprisonment for many years and punished in various ways. When they come out from the prison, again they start the same way of life. We have met many of them. So punishment cannot train or develop human mind. By realizing this, the Buddha's way of teaching, there you cannot find any religious punishment. Either beating or cutting or shooting or torturing the physical body. Buddhism never agreed with this. The Buddha's idea is, physical body is not responsible for our mistake. Then why do we torture the physical body? If you want to stop all those dangerous, immoral and harmful activities, what we have to do? First, we must study the character or the behavior or the temperament or the attitudes of those people and find out why they want to violate. For what purpose? Is it for fun or due to the poverty? Or to take revenge, if not due to their ignorance, or is it their habits or way of life? Find out the reason. So during the 45 years of the Buddha's life, when you study the whole lifetime, how he spent, by approaching such people, when he come to know that there are some people who violate the peace and who disturb innocent people and who are very cruel, he goes there and talk to this person or this group, because he can understand where the mistakes in their mind. Why do they want to make such mistakes? So by realizing this, he directly preach, gives some advice that which appeal to their mind. Then they change their life. When you take few examples, can understand this very clearly. All of you know Angulimala, murderer, gangster, terrorist, who had killed more than 1,000 human beings. Even the king also did not approach him, scared. He could not stop his terrorism. So by realizing this situation, the Buddha went to see him in the jungle. But he knew, simply by preaching at once, it is difficult for him to train this young man. He had more than few hundred techniques of preaching. That is very important. How he approached and what sort of technique he has adopted to preach or to enlighten individual cases, not the same method. In certain places he stood like giant. In certain places he obeyed like a small child by knowing the mentality. In certain cases he allowed people to abuse and accuse and insult him by using all the available words in their vocabulary. He was listening patiently, allow them to express their views. Now then he started. There are very interesting hundreds of cases. So this young man, Angulimala, he wanted to kill the Buddha, to complete his vow, last person. So he was very happy when he saw the Buddha, another human being is coming. He never knew that this is a great religious teacher. So he wanted to catch him, then started to run by holding his sword. The Buddha walked in normal way without running. He did not run. He walked as usual. But Angulimala started running and running and running and running as much as possible, till speed. But he could not reach the Buddha. For nearly 4 miles he had to run. But he cannot reach the Buddha. Now see, this is the technique. Now he cannot run anymore, so tired. Then he asked, stop. Now then the Buddha knew, this is the time for me to talk to him. Before that he did not utter even one word. Then he said, do you know, I have stopped long ago. You are the one who runs. is an educated young man, he knew there must be something very meaningful say. And he said, what does it mean? How can you say you have struck? I saw you also walk. Yes, I walk, but I did not run. But you run. Then he asked, what is the reason that I could not catch you? Because you run. If you stop your running, then you can catch me. By running, you cannot catch me. He cannot understand. Then he explained, I told you, I have stopped long ago, violating, disturbing, torturing these others. I have stopped long ago. I told you, you are running. That means you kill innocent people. And because of this, you have to run such a long period within this wheel of life by suffering. Do you know that? So at once he realized his mistake. He admitted. So he threw away his sword and asked, can I follow you? Yes, why not? He followed the Buddha. Same day he was ordained as a monk. Number one murderer, gangster, terrorist who terrorized the whole country, the whole area. Within one day became a holy man. See how he could manage to change the way of life of a murderer. No punishment there. So punishment is not the solution. Now let us take another incident. Alavaka, supposed to be a devil, cannibal, who lived on human flesh. Yes. Killed so many human beings and enjoyed their flesh and blood. By knowing this, the Buddha approached this person, most dangerous devil. He went alone. Usually when he goes out, sometimes he invites some of his disciples also. But that day he went alone. So when he approached him or visited his place, he was out, not in his cave, just like Batu caves. So he went inside the cave and down in the same place on his seat. When he came, Alavaka, he saw somebody sitting in his seat. He could not believe his eyes. There's nobody in this world who can come into my house and sit down in my chair. Who is this man? Then he thought, instead of killing him at once, better to torture him. After torturing, I can kill him. Just like a cat, you know, after catching a rat, doesn't kill at once. Allow that rat to run a little bit again, go and catch and play again, allow that. That is the way how the cat enjoys. So Alavaka also wanted to do the same thing with the Buddha. What he did, he came and threatened the Buddha. He said, get up. The Buddha obeyed him, listened to him. He got up. Then he said, get up. He slowly woke up, the Buddha. And he went up to the door, the Jain, he said, come here. He came, sit down. Jain, he sat down. He said, get up. Jain, he got up. Get out. Jain, he went out. 3 times he has done this. 4th time, when he said, get up. Then the Buddha stood like a giant there. He said, I am not going to obey you. You can do anything whatever you like. Oh, the devil cannot understand what is happening now. Who is this devil? You know, devil cannot understand. And he said, if you are not going to obey, I'll take you, your leg, and throw to the other bank of the river. There was a river around that area. Then the Buddha said, when you read Alaukka Sutta in Paritta chanting book, you can see the word uttered by the Buddha. He said, how the Buddha threatened him. Nakvahantam avasu pasami sadevake loke samarake sabrahmake sasamana brahmaniya pajaya sadeva manuse. You must understand, there is nobody in this universe, not only in this world, even in so-called heaven or Brahma world or Mara or any kind of world where there are supernatural living beings, who can do that? Who can torture me like that? Try and see. Now, Alavaka could not understand what to do. He got frightened. Then he changed his attitude. He said, all right. Now I am going to ask some questions. You could not answer my question. He said, I am going to split your heart and kill you on the spot. Then the Buddha said again, don't talk too much. Don't waste your time. If you have any questions, you can ask. Then he started a series of questions, very meaningful ones. In Alavaka Sutta, you can see, Kinsudavit. Tang purisasa settang king su suchinno sukhamavahati king su have sadhu tarang rasanang kathang jivin jivita mahu settang. There are 4 here, 4 questions. Now the first question, kinsu the vittang purisasa settang. What is the highest, most valuable wealth for human beings? Diamond, isn't it? Gold or diamond or money, what is the most valuable wealth for the mankind, the human being? And the Buddha gave the answer only for that one. Saddhida vittam purisasa settam. Saddha. Faith, confidence is the highest wealth for the mankind. It is true. Whatever you do in your life, whether you are married life, business, or religious practices, or any other thing, if you do that without confidence, it will become a failure. You had to cultivate full confidence in your work. That is what the Buddha says, Saddhida Vittam Purisasa Settam. The highest wealth for the man is Saddha. Saddha means confidence. Usually people cannot understand the deep meaning of the sayings of the Buddha. We measure his sayings in worldly way. That is why we cannot catch the real meaning. So he answered all the questions. In the end, what happened? He had to kneel down in front of the Buddha and say, "I am the most fortunate person today. With compassion towards me, you have visited my place. I am benefited. I was in the dark. Now I realize the truth. Forever, I follow you as my master, my teacher." He became a very devout Buddhist. How he trained that cannibal? Without torturing, without any religious punishment, by knowing what this person needs and where the mistake is. All the others, when they talk about their religion, they say punishments and torturing and cutting and shooting and God punished them. Why it is necessary to punish? What is the difficulty for God to correct us? This is my argument. Why does God want to wait until we die to punish us? What is the difficulty for him to stop when we make mistakes, when we violate others, when we disturb others? He cannot do that. Then how do we know that he has really saved us? What have you got to prove? This is the Buddha's method. We can correct it if we know the method. So punishing them, we cannot correct them. They keep quiet because of fear, but no changes in the mind. But whenever chances arise, again they commit the same mistake. No development, no understanding. So the Buddhist method is to cultivate the mind. Make them to understand their own mistake. Don't create fear in their mind to avoid the mistake. When that fear is no more in that mind, again they make the same mistake. People cannot understand this. Human beings are very peculiar type of living beings. Very difficult to understand their minds, their way of life. All the other living beings in this world, if you can understand their way of life, we can see there is some sort of disciplinary code. Animals also follow some sort of discipline. And even devils and ghosts and devas and brahmas and other living beings also have their own disciplinary code. But human beings have no discipline. Because of their cunningness and selfishness, they can violate anything for their own benefit. Cannot trust each other because of this situation. Now you can see those animals, cows, goats, horses, elephants, from morning up to evening, they go here and there in searching their something for them to eat, grass and leaves and this and that. In the evening, when they wanted to go back to the place where they live, and one of them always act as a leader. When you observe, you can see this very carefully. When that animal start to lead all the others, slowly, 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 follow. Then you can see how they follow each other and reach home. When the time comes, they have some discipline. But we think we are educated. We think we have religion. We think we are cultured and civilized. But our way of life is actually more uncultured than animals. Now, if we cannot trust each other, what sort of culture is there? How can we say we are cultured people? If I am trying to bluff you by using my religion, if you try to bluff me by adapting all sort of funny methods, then how can we say we have a religion to practice? Only human beings can do that. Others never do. In fact, religion has become a very strong force or very fertile soil for cunning people to make use of innocent people. Bluffing, swindling, cheating, threatening, frightening in the name of religion. They take the advantage of all these innocent people. They use name of religion for that. And people cannot understand what is happening. People cannot understand why they are so keen, why they take so much of troubles and pain to come and convert us or to teach us. For what purpose? Because they are very kind to us for their own benefit, misleading innocent people. Education. What is the purpose of education those days? The main purpose of education is to cultivate man's way of life, discipline, behavior, conduct. That is why education is needed, only for that purpose. But today, can you find all the good qualities in the modern education? They form their gangsters. They are gangs. Gangsters get together, those students, they form their gang to fight and attack each other in the school. And what is the purpose of their education? It is called job-oriented education. Everybody wants to learn to find out a job, but not to train their mind, not to discipline their mind, not to cultivate their way of life. No such idea in the modern education. Job. That is why there is a very keen competition. And many young boys and girls go mad halfway because of this tension and worry, thinking that they cannot find out a suitable job. There will be no future according to this education in this country or that country, then they go mad. The main purpose of education is to learn how to live cultured human beings on this earth. No such thing. Education has become a real torture to innocent children. Why? Because of this competition. They have no time to play. They have no time to relax. And they have no time to develop their affection between parents and children. No time. All the while go neither reading or learning or doing this or tuitions or this and that. What purpose? Job, 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 job. Job oriented. But those days, they had enough time to relax, enough time to play, and enough time to spend with their family members, get together, all those things are gone. So education also never contribute anything to train human mind. But modern education support ordinary devils to become very clever devils, that's all. All those violences, disturbances and calamities, disasters in this world, organized by educated people, using their scientific knowledge, technology, but not by stupid or uneducated people. That is the fate of modern education. So whatever we handle today, whether religion or education or politics or anything, everywhere you can see corruption, selfishness and cunningness. So every day we are going on grumbling. When you read the newspaper, how many good news are there in the newspaper? And who are those people? Human beings. Have you ever heard any devils or any ghost enter into a bank or a jewelry shop and taken away all the valuable things by force? Any ghost or devil? Well-dressed gentleman went up nicely, shake hand, how are you? Oh, long time no see. Within a few minutes, they become devil. Human beings. This is the nature of human beings too. So, here in this sutra, Mahasihanada Sutra, the Buddha says, when rulers started to punish people thinking that they can stop all the violence, and they have become more violent and more aggressive and used their full efforts and knowledge and energy to escape from the punishment. Then, when this situation was aggravated, the man has developed very dangerous, poisonous cruelty, hatred, and to take revenge. And these two things, cruelty and hatred, are the most dangerous weapons in our mind. At that time, we completely lose our human dignity, human intelligence, sense of reasoning, no more. Because those things are boiling in our mind. And we can do any dirty, wicked and dangerous things at that time. Now the situation is aggravated. How evil practices have become very common. Then, human conduct, behavior, and bluffing and cheating, and various other illegal, indecent practices started to develop. Among all the other immoral practices, most dangerous immoral practice is the sex abuse. Others are not that bad. Because living beings can control many other things. But sex urge is a strong force. Because of this, they can violate all the other principles and good qualities, and no shame, no fear, nothing. Gone everything. You can see how these things are spreading. But in those days, people are very shameful. Still there are certain countries, poor countries, who maintain shame and fear when they come to this area. But in many other countries, it has become so common, people can announce and they can glorify about their sex life. Tell others also, you know, I got so many boyfriends, I got so many girlfriends, they are proud. You see, the way of life. Then, how they started their harsh, wicked and frivolous talk. Earlier, although they were very violent and wicked, they did not use these things publicly. Secretly, they have violated. Now they are using their words to abuse, to accuse, to insult, and to hurt. Using all the available vulgar and wicked words. Human beings are the only living being, according to the Buddha. I do not know, the Buddha says. When you read Anguttara Nikaya, one of the sutras, Sutra Pitaka, he says, long, long ago there were some kind of living beings on this earth, it's called Kinnara. Nara means human. Body is animal and head is human. And people strongly believe long ago there were such living beings on this earth. So according to anthropology, we can accept this without any difficulty, the evolution. So since they had human head, human mouth, they could talk just like human beings. But here the Buddha says like this, by considering two things, they did not use the human language, these animals, animal body and human head. It is mentioned in Anguttara Nikaya, if I remember. Dveme bhikkhave attavasa kimpurisa manusing vachang nabhasam. By considering these two things, those kimpurisa or kinnara, the half-human living being, did not speak human language. So what are those two things? If they used human language, they had to tell lies. Because others never tell lies. If they use human language, they had to scold others. So according to these sayings of the Buddha, other living beings never scold at each other and never tell lies. Of course, when a dog barks at another dog, we may think that they are scolding each other, but we cannot understand their language. They are expressing some their idea, but according to the Buddha, we cannot believe that they scold at each other. And they never tell lies. This is the problem with human beings. Very clever to tell lies. They know how to twist and change and hide and say something else. Small children, kids, know how to tell lies. Who taught them? That is why it is very difficult to control. The animals we can control by beating, threatening, frightening. But we cannot control human beings because of this. Now, when we come to religion, actually, other living beings have no religion. They do not know anything about religion, but they have some principles. And we too had certain principles when we were practicing humanism. No Buddhism, Hinduism, Christianity, Islam or anyism at that time. These religions never appeared at that time. All these things are later developed. But human beings lived on this earth millions of years. At that time, they had their own principles. That is called humanism. What does it mean? Two principles govern the whole mankind. Shame and fear. These two things. They are ashamed to do immoral, wicked things. Therefore, they don't want to do that. They are scared of violating, disturbing, torturing, killing others. Shame and fear. It is called moral shame and moral fear. Morality is behind. That is humanism. There are some living beings, human beings in the jungle. Still they have no religion. Aborigines in many countries, they have no religion, but they have very strict principles. That is humanism according to their way of life. They maintain some sort of human dignity and observe certain principles. But they have no idea about God and punishment or reward or rebirth or this or that. They have no idea. When all these things incorporated with humanism, they have introduced religion. Earlier, in that humanism, there is no God, no rebirth, no karma. So what these religionists have done, they have accepted existing humanism and incorporated all extra. Now take for instance, when Buddhism was introduced to China, nearly 2,000 years ago, they were following Confucianism and Laozi. But these practices were there in India also at that time. When you study that young man, Sigala, who started to worship every morning in the six directions, every morning, according to his father's instructions, Now then the Buddha approached him. Asked, young man, what are you doing? Then he said, I am following my father's instructions. Because this young man had no religion. Father knew that he is not willing to follow any religion. Then he taught this. Before his death, you must obey my advice. Every morning, as soon as you get up, you must go out and worship the six directions. So he had been doing this. Now then the Buddha came to see him. Asked, what are you doing? My father asked me to do this. Do you know the meaning of this? He said, I do not know. I follow my father's advice. Then the Buddha has given the practical and meaningful idea. Worshipping the east and the west and south and north and east and west. He says, respect your father and mother. Fulfill your duties towards your wife and husbands and children and teachers. And fulfill your duties without neglecting them. Your servants, your relatives, your friends, your attendants. That is the meaning of worshipping the six directions. Simply by worshipping, you won't gain anything. And these systems were there in China and India and many other countries at that time. When Buddhism was introduced to China, they realized that there are some new ideas that they have never heard in China. That is why they accepted. What are those things? They never had any idea or clear vision or understanding of life hereafter. What will happen to us after our death? Buddhism teaches this very clearly. They accept it. And they had no idea about the cause and effect or the karmic effect. So when you observed, they found out, yes, it is true. They accepted Buddhism. That is why Buddhism has become the most popular religion in China. But they have never given up their existing belief and practices. Although they have accepted new concept, new belief, new ideas from Buddhism, they followed the same existing practices. That is why we say this is Chinese Buddhism and that is Indian Buddhism. In India also, when you study very carefully, you can see so many Indian practices we follow as Buddhism. The Buddha did not encourage us to follow these things. So when you study Chinese Buddhism, actually, 90% Chinese tradition, culture and practices, maybe 10% Buddhist idea. But that is Chinese Buddhism. It is natural. When you go to another country, Japan, Korea, Tibet, Mongolia, also the same thing. When you go to Thailand, people say pure Buddhism is there, Theravada Buddhism is there. But go and study very carefully. What sort of practices are there? What sort of belief are there? What sort of traditions are there? Can you prove this is the pure Buddhism? Can you say these are the things taught by the Buddha? No. Their own traditional practices. Even Sri Lanka and Burma, their own traditional practices. But we should not accuse or blame or condemn people because they accept this thing as their cultural practice. So, human mind, as I mentioned earlier, is very peculiar and difficult to train. Now, we have mentioned punishment, rewarding, threatening, frightening. we could not stop evil, immoral and wicked practice. Then religions interfere. One group of religions tried to train man's mind by bringing forward the concept of God. So that concept is very important to many people. If you violate this, God will punish you. Many people accept. They believe. And because of this belief in God, they do not want to do bad things. In that sense, belief in God is not bad. We cannot say it is bad. Then when you do this kind of good deeds to serve others or practice certain principles or virtues and good qualities, then the God will reward you. God like you. God love you. Now then they practice. Otherwise they don't want to do any good things. So the majority here in this world keep away from certain bad things because of God. And they also do some service to others because of God. Otherwise they never do. And then another religious group says, forget about God. Whether God exists or not, that is not the important issue here. You must understand. Use your common sense and understanding. Why you should not do bad things? Don't think you cannot understand. You can. Because of your selfish idea, your craving, you don't like to stop. Then, by considering your way of life, comparing your way of life with others, you can understand how you feel and how others feel when you go and violate them, attack them. So whether God exists or not, this is more than enough for you to understand why it is bad. By thinking in this way, we give a chance for our mind to think. Otherwise we never think. When you think there is a God to punish us, to reward us, you stop your thinking. You never think. You think God is responsible for everything. Yeah, open your mind. Think unbiasedly. Now then you can understand whether God exists or not. That this is wrong, this is bad, this is harmful. Now then realization, understanding appear in your mind. Through that understanding or realization, you can stop this. Again, do good. Do some service to others. Don't be so selfish. Think of others. Then people ask, what for? Why should we support others? For what purpose? Then they say, if you do that, God will reward you. God will send you to heaven. In that case, we don't mind. Otherwise, you don't know how to do that. Here, the other religions say, forget about God. What is the purpose of your living in this world? For what purpose? What are the duties? If you can understand this, you know how to appreciate, how to value that your services are needed to others. Other services are needed towards you. our mutual understanding and cooperation and harmony gives us confidence, moral support for us to live peacefully, without fear, without suspicion. Therefore, we must cooperate with others. We must support others. We must give others moral support. That is called service. So the God is not important for this. This is the Buddha's way of teaching. If God exists, so much the better, no harm. Don't try to say there is no God. What for? Don't say like that. But we can do all these things without depending on anybody. Our understanding is the important thing here. Then, ill will, covetousness, and various other evil forces started to develop in our human mind. Now you can see how all the evil forces appear one after the other. As I mentioned the other day, at the beginning, human minds were very pure, not immoral, not bad, not wicked, not selfish, not greedy. Then others say, when the devil appeared, the devil influenced human beings to commit all the evil things. Now the devil is responsible for our greed, our anger, our jealousy, and all the evil forces. So we blame devil. The Buddhism says, or Buddhism never talk anything about devil here. Devil has nothing to do with this. Then how such pure, innocent human minds were polluted? I told you the last Friday. Although we could manage to suppress, control our mind to maintain purity, we have not eradicated completely, not uprooted completely our craving, hatred, and ignorance. When circumstances arise, those hidden evil forces in our mind flare up, astir. Then we develop greed, hatred, anger, jealousy, then went on developing one after the other. This is the Buddha's way of interpretation. Devil has nothing to do with this. Later, when more and more evil forces, wicked thoughts, selfish ideas, immoral practices prevailed, completely polluted the normal human mind, then people become a skeptic. They say, religion is useless, God is useless, there is nothing hereafter, enjoy as much as we can, don't believe all this rubbish, what others talk. It is spreading now. I think majority here in this world maintain this. Although they have their own religious labels, but in their heart, they have this belief. only for the name's sake, they may perform certain religious rites and rituals. I heard in the West, majority, what do they say? Only three times during our lifetime we visit the church. Only three times. After giving birth, to baptize. Then for the marriage. And the last trip is the funeral. Only these three occasions we visit the church. Besides these three things, we never think of religion. This is their way of life. And what about this part of the world? Here in this part of the world, what is happening? We have more religious rites and rituals and ceremonies and thousands and one thing. In the name of religion, we develop all these things, but religion is not there. We spend thousands and thousands of dollars to perform certain rites and rituals, either to glorify, just to show off, or because of fear, but no religious feeling. Therefore we say religion exists here. It is not religion. If we really want to be religious, actually those practices are not so important. But since we have organized these practices in the name of religion, we maintain our religious tradition. Through these religious practices and tradition, we maintain some sort of heritage. So religion has become our cultural heritage. That is why you say this is our religion. Cultural heritage, this is our religion. And that feeling, the our or my religion, protect and maintain to carry on this religious traditional practice. But in the West, you cannot find so much religious rites and rituals and ceremonies. So real religious feeling is not there in the man's mind. Although they perform so many religious activities, although they spend so much money and devote their time just to glorify, if not by seeking more and more power or authority, if not more and more income, they become very active. If such facilities are no more, they don't become active in the religious field. So it clearly shows there is no real religious feeling in their hearts. After this a skeptical belief and ideas that there is nothing hereafter, we can enjoy our life. Not necessary for us to be kind or honest. Try to earn as much as possible to enjoy our life. These beliefs are very common. then what will happen? There is no unity, no harmony, no understanding, no cooperation. Their way of life is just like trees, plants in the jungle. One plant has no connection with the other plant. They grow individually. No cooperation. So our human life also becomes like this. You don't care for others, then not even your own family life. You can neglect your wife or your husband or your children or your relatives. Too much of individualism. The idea that I don't care for others is the main purpose in their life. I want to enjoy myself. I don't care for others. I don't care whether they suffer or not. No humane feeling. Now see how we are going down and down and down and down. And we do not know where we are at this juncture. So when this situation goes down and down, physically, mentally, culturally, our maximum lifetime goes down to 10 years. Now 65. 10 years. 10 years old male or female become grandfather and grandmother at that time. More and more sicknesses, new sicknesses already started. Very funny sicknesses spreading all over the world. Human behavior, human mind are responsible for this, for these new sicknesses. Our appearance, no real human appearance, very artificial. All these senses that we are using today, in time to come, we have to use extra gadgets, otherwise cannot make use of them. Now, teeth. Small children also must go to dentist. Teeth are decaying. Those days they never hurt us, because their food that they take prevents these sicknesses, protect, strengthen their teeth. Those days they never used glasses. Small children also, nearly 50% in certain countries, at the age of 7, 10, 15, they use their glasses. Otherwise they cannot read. About 50 to 100 years ago, we never heard this kind of thing. Hearing also. All the five senses, in time to come, we have to use gadgets. Five gadgets. Otherwise, cannot use. Not only that. Because of modern scientific discoveries, thinking that we can enjoy our life on this earth, we completely pollute the whole atmosphere. Pollute the water, air. Then, we cannot breathe the normal polluted. So Each and every person must use some oxygen tank here for breathing. Go to Japan and certain area, they cannot live without using this gadget. Polluted completely their factories and the water, certain rivers and the sea water, the fish, if they eat, funny kind of sicknesses because certain chemical poisonous things completely polluted. Fish, their way of life. All these are our work. So don't blame God or devil. Now we can understand why the Buddha says that our maximum lifespan goes down to 10. Without changing our way of life, without changing our mind, without realizing our mistake, whatever religion we believe, whether we believe in God or not, whether we pray or not, no one can stop this deterioration, a declining, going down and down and down. Forever we are going on grumbling and blaming and accusing. No satisfaction in our life. But we never admit we are digging our own grave, our mistake. So one day they will realize. Nobody else who come down from heaven to correct all these things. Only through our understanding. So today we stop here, number 16. 8 items I have discussed today. There are some more. It's a long way to go.